Welcome to Christ Clarity Reassurance. We are reassuring you here. You're being reassured. Not in a way that the ego wants to be reassured, though. All spiritual talk of dialogue and inquiry, etc., it all loops back to the very same place, which is the continuity problem. That's the only problem we really have. We can spend all this time boiling everything down, and when you boil it down, it's the continuity problem. There is no other problem. There is no other issue that needs to be addressed, actually. None. So all this time we spend in other pursuits is a waste of time. The way to save time is to say the continuity problem is the only issue that needs to be resolved, and start with that as your basic premise. Now, the real teachings, the teachings of truth are so different than what the ego teaches. It's like night and day, night and day, night and day. And yet you cannot integrate the two teachings. They cannot be integrated because they cancel each other out and lead to just severe mental confusion. So one has to at least start with a premise, with a faith. You cannot simply say, well, my premise is to combine the two. There's no spiritual path there then. There is none, because you're not going on any spark of truth at all. And so that's to deny that the spiritual path. See, there's no way to know anything, so let's just go on that premise. It's not true. The spiritual path starts when you get a glimpse of truth, and then you say, okay, how do I know there is truth. I know there is freedom from problems. How do I get there? That is the path. Otherwise, people only engage in trying to, let's just throw everything in there and see what happens. That's a waste of time. It's a waste of time. That doesn't work. That's a denial of reality, a denial that there's an answer, and that doesn't work. So, I've said many, many things on all these videos, but all boils down to the continuity issue is the only issue that needs to be addressed. Now, the resolution to the situation is to see the vision of oneness. Another way of putting it is to see a world where there are no problems. The answer to a world, seeing a world of problems, is to see a world with no problems. Okay, that is the answer. It is not to solve the problems of the world that has problems. That's the ego's agenda. That doesn't solve the continuity problem at all. In fact, it makes it worse. It makes it worse. See, the ego doesn't see a continuity problem as it is. Everything the ego does makes the problem worse, the continuity problem worse. So it's not wise to follow the ego. The continuity problem is really how to stop dreaming. How to stop dreaming. That's the continuity problem. Let's say you are sitting on a veranda of a beautiful, beautiful palace, an unbelievably lush garden surrounded you, and the birds were all singing, and the music and the fragrance, and it was just, you know, paradise. You were sitting in paradise, and you sort of slipped into a whimsical reverie, and you suddenly saw a mirage out on the horizon, shimmering on the horizon, and it was a mirage of a desert, a barren desert, where everything was desperately thirsty, and everyone was, you saw all these images of forms stumbling and dying into the dust, and it was a horrible mirage, and you're like, whoa, what is this? This is terrible. Oh my gosh. And your attention was riveted on this mirage, and you say, well, look at that poor animal going along with no water, and they're stumbling and crumbling into the dust under this blazing hot sun. And you're so concerned about this, and you say, oh my gosh, I want to help these, look at these poor people, they're slaving away, look at this world, is so many illnesses and diseases and people dying, and oh my gosh, I want to solve the problems. So you get intensely focused on this mirage. Okay, now, what could I do here? And you're trying to solve all these problems that you're seeing in the mirage. And your friend comes to you, your friend's on the veranda too, looking out over the lush garden, and they see that you're perspiring and shaking and screaming and moaning, and they say, what's wrong with you? And you say, oh my gosh, can't you see all these problems? I'm trying to solve these problems. It's very important. These poor people are suffering. And you say to them, well, what problems? What are you talking about? What problems? They said, well, they're right out there. Look, look, this is terrible. So these friends are having a conversation on the veranda. And the friend says to the one who's seen the mirage, hey, there's no mirage out there. You're seeing a mirage. You're dreaming. You're dreaming. No, everything, the lush, beautiful lushness is still right here. It hasn't disappeared or anything. There's nothing else other than that. There's no desert out there. There's no dying people out there. There's no death out there at all. And the one who's seen this mirage says, what are you talking about? You're crazy. I'm seeing it plain and simple. Well, of course, they're hallucinating. So what do you do for someone who's hallucinating? That's the question. That's really the question we face here. What do you do with someone who's hallucinating like that? You don't tell them, well, you got to stop hallucinating because there's a continuity problem. If they're seeing this mirage, they're wrapped up in this mirage of death, and they're too frightened to drop it. Because they think there'd be nothing. If they drop it, there'd be nothing. They don't realize they're hallucinating. So if they felt they dropped this hallucination, they would be faced with annihilation, nothing. And also underneath, they're afraid that also there's some kind of remembrance, hazy remembrance, that there's some beautiful lushness. And they say, wait a minute, the difference between this beautiful lushness and this horrible world of death I'm seeing, it is so extreme, that I feel like I would be disoriented if I dropped this hallucination. That's the real underlying fear. There's a fear of disorientation, of discontinuity, abrupt discontinuity. That's why we call it the continuity problem. So you would say to your friend, okay, friend, you see all this terrible. There's a world full of all this death and suffering, etc. Wow. Okay. Here's the answer. See a world with all this stuff that you're hallucinating, but see a world where there aren't all these problems, where there aren't all these problems. Everything is fine, is refreshed. Everyone's full of refreshment. Everything is fresh. No lack of freshness. No lack of hydration. Everything is hydrated. Everything is fresh. Nothing is dying. See a world like that. And then the goal would be then to have them hallucinate a happy hallucination. Because they believe that this hallucinating they're doing is somehow creation. This is what is real. It's not. They don't want to drop that function. It's too, it feels too, it would be too abrupt for them. They have a fear of dropping their hallucinating. That's where the fear of abruptness comes from. The fear of continuity problem comes from, is they don't want to drop their hallucinating. So the only remedy is to get them, convince them to hallucinate differently. A different hallucination. They can do that. When you're hallucinating, you can hallucinate some different hallucination. If you're the people who in the 60s and who dropped acid and they were hallucinating and they had a bummer, a bad trip. They call it a bummer. They had a bad trip. They were hallucinating all these demons and snakes and horrible stuff that just absolutely, well, you couldn't say, hey, they're not there, because they're seeing them. And they say, what are you talking about? You're crazy. They'd say that you're crazy. If you ever were, someone was on a bad trip, they'd say you're crazy. You know, you needed they needed and then, you know, dangerous. It could get dangerous because they're saying, no, I need to get away. I'd be chased by these goblins, you know. And you say, no, there's no goblins. They say, well, no, you're nuts. You're trying to get me killed. You know, we need to run. Whew, scary stuff. So you could say to them, okay, you're seeing goblins. All right. Now, hey, use your power to see that you are, how would you say it? Okay, you have to involve some process because they're hallucinating. So, okay, now what we need to do, and then there's a way to get them into hallucinating a beautiful scenario. Beautiful scenario. That's kind of what a therapist does. What a therapist really does is guide people in the sense of continuity and process into a beautiful dream, a beautiful hallucination. That's what therapy really is. That's all that it is. Instead of seeing that everybody's out, the goblins are out to get you, you might say, well, why don't you take a look at that, look at that goblin's face, or look at that, well, look at what the goblin's wearing. They change clothes. And they say, huh? Yeah, they're wearing this beautiful robe. You see the robe the goblin's wearing? Oh, look at the robe, is like scintillating. Look at the robe. And the robe is like sending off waves of beautiful light. Oh, wow. And so you gradually get them to hallucinate that the goblins are wearing beautiful robes, and there's golden light shining off of all the robes that they're wearing. And then they say, oh my gosh, that's so beautiful, so beautiful. They say, hey, look, the plant over there, that's also sending off this golden light too. Wow. And then they're seeing the golden light coming off the plant too. And look at that tree. Oh my gosh, the tree is just scintillating. It's so beautiful. Wow. And before you know it, they've forgotten all about the goblins. And now they're seeing this beautiful world of shimmering light, you see. That is what a therapist does. A therapist, another term is a teacher of God. In other words, teacher of how to solve the continuity problem so we recognize that we never left God and never left reality at all. Teacher of God. Therapist of God. How to hallucinate, how to have a happy hallucination. That's really the only problem we face. So on that veranda in this palace, the therapist, the friend, has to be a therapist and say, hey, look at that desert. Say, oh my God, look at all that sand. You see, the sand is so beautiful. It's so crystallinely, it's radiating with its crystalline structures. It's unbelievably beautiful. Yeah, I see that too. And they say, oh yeah, yeah it is. Really? You see that? Oh, okay. And gradually you get them to see this beautiful hallucination. Now, how does the friend do that? Well, the friend has to actually be hallucinating also in order to sell it. And so, how is that done in a safe manner? We say that the God gave a blessing to this hallucination. God gave a happy hallucination for us. And that we, the therapists, have to accept that happy hallucination. Otherwise, they won't be so effective with the continuity issue. So the therapists that come into this world to help have to accept the happy hallucination. They have to be hallucinating also. But they have to be hallucinating the happy hallucination. And then they can explain how it looks to others. And others will say, oh, really? Oh, and they can... Hallucination is contagious, actually. Contagious. The mind that is hallucinating is whimsical. And it can easily catch the contagion of another hallucination. Easily. That's why those who are on bad trips could easily go onto a good trip. And those who are on a good trip could also easily go over onto a bad trip if they had the wrong company. See, the company of tripping out was very important, because if you got in bad company, you could have a very bad trip. Now, I was not into this tripping out, but I was in a culture where this was very prevalent. And I was aware of the problems that people have. It's like, wow. And I'd read the books and all this kind of stuff, and I knew of people who were tripping out constantly. A lot of acquaintances I had were, my gosh, they're tripping out so many times. I mean, the people back then took hundreds and hundreds, some thousands of trips, just like amazing stuff. And then they'd have a bummer, a really bad trip, and then that would really mess them up bad. And there was a whole culture of how to avoid these bad trips, etc. So, the truth is that we're all hallucinating. And to come into this world and to be helpful, one has to be hallucinating. If one was not hallucinating at all, there would seem to be a continuity problem. They'd seem to be too high and mighty, as it were. And we couldn't relate to them at all. So if anyone wants to be a therapist, a continuity therapist, let's say, I like that better than teacher of God, I like a continuity therapist, one has to accept the happy hallucination here. And then help others shift their hallucination. So in that example of on the veranda of the palace, they see a beautiful desert. Oh my gosh. And then you say, wow, look at that. Look at that little plant coming up. There's a plant growing up, and oh, it's turning into a beautiful plant. Oh my gosh, look how lush that plant is. And they begin to see what you're seeing. You're seeing the happy hallucination. And they begin to see that, and they begin to hallucinate that way. And then after a while, they say, oh my gosh, I'm seeing a completely lush desert, just utterly lush desert. The desert is so lush and beautiful. Wow, it's fantastic. And then at some point, you might say, my friend, we're both hallucinating, aren't we? And we look at you and say, yeah, we are. Yeah, we are. I say, we can do it for a little while longer. But then we say, you know, this hallucination looks exactly like very similar to not hallucinating, what we'd see when we're not hallucinating. We both say, yeah, that's true. That's true. It's very similar. Then we say, well, why don't we stop hallucinating? And then we stop hallucinating, and you're back on the veranda of the lush gardens around you. So that's how it works. That's literally how it works. Now, the hallucination, the happy hallucination, can also involve moving around, moving about, going different places. You might say, to those who are totally invested in movement, going places, doing things, vacations, you know, working on getting somewhere, whatever. There's another way you can have a happy hallucination. You can say to that one who's in the hallucinating a desert, you can say, wow, yeah, that's a terrible desert. I'll tell you what, let's get in this car and let's start driving. Let's take a vacation from this desert. This is a nasty desert here. Gosh, it's awful. Let's take a vacation. Yeah, let's take a vacation from it. Oh, look at this beautiful car. Wow, that's great. Or you can say, hey, I have this car. Look at this car. It's a fabulous car. Let's get inside. Air conditioned, nice music, everything. Let's go to a resort. There's a resort down the road here. You just have to take a travel on this road here, and there's a beautiful lush resort. We can go to that and get an oasis, desert oasis. Let's get some respite from this blazing hot sun and this desperate thirst and this awful situation. Wow, it's really a bummer. So we get in the car and we drive along, and gradually as we drive along, we see road signs saying, welcome to the desert oasis, and we see some beautiful palm trees, and everything looks more and more beautiful as we're getting closer. And gradually we pull into this gorgeous resort, unbelievably nice resort. And your friend says, wow, I love this place. It's so cool. So much better than the desert. And you say, yeah, well, why don't we stay here? Oh, we have a room here, actually. We have a room. We have a reservation. And so we book into the resort, and we stay there. And gradually we get really used to this. And then we say, hey, you know what? This resort reminds me of someplace. And, of course, it's the beautiful palace, and the grounds of the palace is what it reminds us of. And then we stop hallucinating. So there's that way, too. There's really several ways. It depends on, it's somewhat dependent on the tendencies of people. If the tendencies of people are that they are very sedentary and don't want to go anywhere, they're only into visualization, hallucinating only as just right where they are, then you can have the happy hallucination of just everything becoming, seeing everything is completely beautiful there. But if their tendency is to be mobile, extremely mobile, and that the mobility is central to how they solve the problems of the world, of what they're seeing, of their hallucination. If that's central, then the happy hallucination needs to include mobility. Mobility. Okay, so in the past, the way was to simply see everything as beautiful. Okay. People were not as mobile as we are now. They felt they're pretty much stuck where they are. It's vastly different now. Vastly different. We think nothing of jumping on a jet and flying halfway around the world and going all around, driving everywhere in there, and then flying back. And many people's lives are extraordinarily mobile. I mean, I think nothing of driving 100 miles a day, every day, and going all over the place. I'm over here, over the ocean, and then I'm over the and the mountains, go over the mountains, I'm in the valleys, I'm over this, every day, every day. So many people have very mobile lifestyles, and their whole lifestyle is geared to dealing with this problems of this hallucination we call a world by through mobility. So in that case, in this case, in the modern age, the happy hallucination really is very well served, in many cases best served, by having the happy hallucination being a mobile one, meaning taking a journey, taking a trip, a journey, going to a resort, going to a resort, going to a really beautiful resort. That is actually the better way that I see this. What the Holy Spirit has suggested to me is, hey, we're in a slightly different time and age than the gurus in the past. We're not in Ramana's age. We're really not. Things have radically changed. At that time, you simply sit in a place and sit quietly and abide in that place and have the vision of oneness in that place, seeing the incredible beauty, happy hallucination of your surroundings right there. The temple walls are so beautiful. Everything, the space is beautiful. Everything is immaculately beautiful. The mountain Arunachala is totally beautiful. And you walk up, you see the stones of the mountain, and you go back to the temple and you take a walk. Everything where you are is totally beautiful. And you say, hey, this reminds me of reality. So, but in today's world, again, we are geared differently. We are geared differently. And so the happy hallucination needs to account for this mobility, because we see things in a very different way. We see solutions as connectivity, of rapid connectivity, rapid motion, constantly on the move. So many people in the modern world constantly on the move. It's not like I get up in the morning and there's this little I have a little hut, and next to the hut is this little patch of a rice paddy. And I get up and I work on the rice paddy, and then at the dusk I go back to the hut, and that's my life. That's my life. It's not like that anymore. It's not like that. So we're aware of the entire world. I mean, I'm very aware of the world. Instantly, we can get these photographs and videos from all over the world, and so we just see what's going on, what the world is like everywhere. So it's not enough for us to, at least we believe it's not enough. And since we're the ones that were hallucinating, and hallucination, you have to understand the whims of the hallucinator. To be a therapist, you have to account for it. You can't just dismiss this. You cannot just say, well, that shouldn't be a problem for you. It is a problem. It is a problem. The hallucinator is very whimsical. Those who are hallucinating are very eccentric and whimsical. And so that has to be accounted for to be an effective therapist. So the old style of teaching doesn't really apply so much in this day and age. It's not really effective. That's why people are tuning it out. So what I say, of course, is we need to shift dimensions. We need to go to a different world. Of course, we could hallucinate this world is perfectly beautiful. Absolutely. But that would not engage us in any going somewhere, doing something. See, it would not really, we're not resonating with that anymore. We really are not. But the idea of going somewhere, traveling somewhere, going, let's go to some beautiful resort, that does resonate with people. Say, hey, yeah, I need a vacation from this world. Let's take a vacation from the world. My gosh. So that's why I say ascension, shifting dimensions, going to the death-free realm, all those things. Of course, that's all hallucination. All of existence is hallucination. It's all in the hypothetical. But it's the way to use hallucination effectively now to solve the continuity problem. So that's why I'm working the way that I'm working, saying, yeah, I'm going to pilot a transport ship, going to take us to another world, all that stuff. Of course, that's all hallucination, just as this world's hallucination, just it's all dreaming, it's all imagination, yes. But there's a necessity now for people to go on a beautiful trip. Not by dropping acid or anything like that. No, 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 no. But by actually going through this process of going somewhere. Of going somewhere beautiful, because that's what we do now. Whether it's in movies, in television, videos, books, vacations, work, whatever. The world is so used to going some places. I mean, every weekend where I live in the Silicon Valley area, I mean, a lot of times the place seems deserted on weekends because everybody's going somewhere. They go up to the skiing. They go up to the Sierras, Tahoe. They go up down to Monterey. Right now, the Pebble Beach Pro-Am golf tournament is down in Monterey. And you know, beautiful people. They go down there. They go up to Napa, Sonoma, wine tasting. I don't know where they go, but they go to the beach. They go someplace which for them is beautiful to escape the problems of everyday life. They want to go somewhere beautiful. And we have been doing that for the last 50 years. You know, we've been doing that. Traveling, traveling, traveling. Jump in the RV. They jump in the RV. They go to a lake. They go fishing. They go kayaking. They go canoeing. They go to concerts. It's a mystery to me where they go because I don't go anywhere on weekends. Weekends, I just sit at home working on. I go actually on YouTube, and I go all over the world on YouTube. Actually, travel through history is what I do a lot too. So we have to meet the hallucinator with what they're where they're hallucinating, what they're hallucinating. If they're hallucinating a desert, we have to meet them in the desert. To be a therapist, we have to meet them there. We have to say, yeah, hey, look at this desert. You have to say, yeah, I see it too. But I also see this car. Look at this car. And you have to literally be seeing the car. Otherwise, they'll look at you, what car? And they'll say, are you sure you see a car? You say, yeah, I'm absolutely positive. You have to be absolutely positive. You have to see the car 100%. Or else they will say, wait, they're see, they don't really see it at first. And then you have to convince them there really is a car there. That's how it works. And then you just get in the car and you have to convince them there's a road there. And you have to see it. And then you have to convince them that you're driving down the road. And then you have to convince them you're seeing these beautiful palm trees and it gets more and more beautiful. You have to convince them of this. And once they start being convinced of the power of their own imagination kicks in, and they start seeing it too. They start seeing it too. So, but the therapist has to really 100% see this. Absolutely. Otherwise, you'll both end up suddenly coming to a dead end in the desert because the palm trees will fade out and you'll say, oh my gosh, we're going back into the desert. We're getting lost. Oh, you'll end up again back in the barren, thirsty, horrible situation. So the therapist has to accept a happy hallucination for themselves. And my problem is I say, no, I don't want any hallucinations. Well, then I can't serve as a therapist. That's the problem. So I have my own challenge is to accept a happy hallucination for myself. And that's where I've still come up short, because I'm still saying, well, I don't need to hallucinate at all. I don't want to hallucinate at all. But then I can't help here. So my what I have to still do is accept that happy hallucination. Now, I had a dream a couple nights ago where there was this problem. Two sides of a problem, they weren't agreeing with one another. And I said, oh, they're never going to agree. It's terrible. I have to get some agreement, and they're not agreeing. And then suddenly, there was like total accord. Some total peace accord happened. And these two antagonistic sides within me suddenly completely agreed and accepted the resolution and were in perfect peace and inner peace and accord. I was like shocked. I was very amazed by this. I said, what happened? How is this possible? There's suddenly an inner accord which I didn't have before. So I think it is this agreement to accept the happy hallucination must have happened within me. The two sides reconciled and said, ah, okay, we see what's necessary now. And then I became very assertive. I found myself in a classroom where I was being super intimidated in the past. And I said, no, you can't intimidate me this way anymore. And I stood up to all the bullies in the world, and I was able to do that. It was amazing. So I've been having very good dreams recently, extraordinarily good dreams. clearly, my problem is that I didn't want to accept any hallucination at all. But I'm coming to the realization that that's not helpful. I mean, technically, yes, but from the standpoint of practicality, it's not practical here. It's not practically helpful. It's like you don't go to a hallucinator and say, what desert? There's no desert there. How does that help them? They just start hallucinating more and more severely. They say, you're crazy. Well, they reject you entirely. They say, you're crazy. So you can't help them. You can't help someone if they think you're totally crazy. So what I did to try and deal with that was I saw the world exactly the way everyone's seeing it. Terrible world. So I had this polarization. I don't want to see any world at all. And because of that intransigent rigidity there, it flipped me over into seeing the world the way that all these hallucinators are seeing it without the happy hallucination at all. And therefore, I can't be helpful to anyone. That's the problem. But by easing, both sides easing up and saying, okay, I'm willing to hallucinate, then I will see the happy hallucination. And then I'll be very helpful at that point. People say, well, you're not crazy because you're seeing everything I'm seeing. So I know that, but you're seeing something very beautiful too. So I want that also. So it seems as though I'm going to be helpful in the nick of time because that dream foreshadowed what's going to happen. I'm going to have some amazing inner peace. The whole situation is going to be resolved. And I will see the world. I'll still see the world, except I will see also this whole plan of evacuating the world, exiting the world, going to a safer place. All this stuff will, I'll literally see it all happening. I'll be aware of it happening. Of course, that too is hallucination. Everything in imagining is hallucination. Everything. But to be helpful, one has to be willing to accept hallucinating temporarily. Temporarily, it's necessary. I'm already hallucinating this world right now, but I'm hallucinating it in the way that in a way that is awful and terrible. It's not helpful because I want to get rid of hallucinations. So I want to have a terrible hallucination so I can get rid of all hallucinations. I don't want to hallucinate. So I said, well, I'll hallucinate awful, awful hallucination, and then I'll drop it all together. Well, that's good for me, but it's not a therapeutic thing for others. So that is the accord that I saw this dream being resolved. I saw it being resolved amazing, miraculously. It's like a miracle. The two sides I thought would never agree with one another suddenly agreed. Miracle. So I would suppose that I'm going to be very helpful for many in the days ahead. I would suppose that. Because I'm going to be having a happy hallucination and everything is going to be crystal clear for me. And then people will say, oh, really? There really is these transport ships and there really is a place to go. I say, yeah, I'll be seeing it, literally seeing it flawlessly. And then people will be then say, oh, I see it too. Yeah, I see it now. Like that. And that's what's helpful. Because the issue is in this world now is there are many who want to continue on with this hallucinating this horrible death scenario. In fact, they want to make it even more, try to make it even more real. See, there's some, the purpose of hallucinating is to make death real. That's literally what the purpose is. We can give it a different purpose though. See, we can give hallucination a different purpose, which is the purpose of not trying to make death real. We can give it that purpose. Because God didn't give hallucination its purpose to start out with. We gave the hallucination its purpose. It was a means to an end, a means to try and make death real and overcome it. And of course, that could only be done in hallucination. Because in reality, there is no death. So how can we make death real and overcome it? It's impossible. But by hallucinating death, then we can also hallucinate that we survive it. We can hallucinate an afterlife also, or our after death realm too, which we are doing. So that's the purpose we gave hallucination. But God suggested a different purpose, suggested saying, hey, look, you can also hallucinate a situation where there is no death. You can also hallucinate that. which is true, we can. And God says that'll solve the continuity problem. You can drop hallucinations altogether. So this is very correct, very much the right way to go about it, that use hallucinations to overcome the continuity problem. Use it instead of rejecting it altogether. And my problem was I rejected it. I said, no, forget it. I hate hallucinations. Let's just drop them altogether. That doesn't help anyone. It helps me, but it doesn't, not helping anyone else, it really doesn't help me, because we're all one. And out of compassion, we will try and help. And so I cannot really return to realize I never left reality and have all my other brothers and the sonship of spirit, the sonship, all the other aspects of the sonship still hallucinating and screaming and misery and terror. And then I'll say, I got to go help them. So it really hasn't solved my problem to just not hallucinate at all. That doesn't solve the continuity problem, because I still have to find a way to help everyone else deal with their continuity problem. And they're not able to just drop hallucinating just like that. No. So I have to accept hallucinating, but happy hallucination. Temporarily, of course. Because eventually when you do that, then those who do that with you, we all agree, we've just been hallucinating. We can drop it now. So it does have a totally happy ending. It's just temporarily I have to accept a happy hallucination. So I'm working to convince myself this is necessary. And I guess that dream showed me, one, it's possible, and two, it may be coming for me. It may actually be coming for me. And at that point, there's genuine help is possible at that point. Really genuine help is possible. Because everything will work out the way that you see it working out. Again, in a hallucination, anything at all can seem to work out for you. you're hallucinating and things work out for you. Everything's working out for you. So things are not working out for me now because I want to see a terrible hallucination so I can drop hallucination altogether. So I'm hallucinating a terrible situation for myself. But I don't have to do that. I can hallucinate a wonderful situation for myself. And then people will see, hey, what a great situation you have. And they'll be attracted to that, and then say, hey, and I also have this interdimensional transport vehicle too. Look at that. Say, wow, you do. That's amazing. And let's try it out. And I can also take this to other worlds, other dimensions, and go to a beautiful death-free dimension. Let's go there. Let's take a trip there. And we don't have to go there instantly. We can meander a little bit, like down a river. Meander on a river here, go on the riverbank here, and everywhere, every time we go around a riverbank, it's more and more beautiful. Oh my gosh, more and more lush and beautiful. Absolutely, we can do that. So what I'm doing now is emphasizing taking a trip, as it were, along somewhere, taking a trip in highways and byways, because that's what we're at. We're at mobility. So we need to utilize mobility in going any place, as it were. In going to the death-free realm, shifting dimensions, we need to use the theme of taking a trip, being mobility, a journey, taking a journey. That's what we need to do now. So I'm emphasizing, I'm making other videos that emphasize taking a journey. Taking a journey, going on a beautiful journey. It's necessary. It is necessary. And what do you need on a journey? A guide, a pilot, a driver, someone who's piloting the plane, driving the car, the boat, piloting the boat, tour guide. To reassure people, now you're seeing this place, and now you're seeing this place, and here over here we see this. So you need a tour guide, a pilot, a tour guide. We need refreshments, we need hospitality, all these things. So all those roles will be filled by the various people here that I'm reaching out to, is fulfill those various roles. And then there'll literally be an exodus from this planet, because those who want to keep hallucinating, trying to make death real, they're very strong and they're hallucinating now. And they're hallucinating very severely these events that take place in this planet, the destruction of the planet, destruction of life on this planet. severe catastrophes, deaths, severe turbulence. They're hallucinating that, and there's so many of them, and they're so intensely into this that if we don't hallucinate another scenario, we will be entrained into their scenario. Because again, the mind of a hallucinator is very fickle and easily pulled one direction or the other. And if there's too much intensity of hallucinating a death scenario, we can easily be pulled into that. Easily. So that's why there needs to be a parting of the ways now. It is the parting of the ways between different hallucinations. The wheat from the chaff, the sheep from the goats. This is at the end times, the apocalypse, end times. We're right at that time now where there is a parting of the ways of what kind of hallucinate. What are we going to hallucinate? Are we going to hallucinate a death-free realm? Or are we going to hallucinate a realm where everything's being destroyed and massacred and die, death? Which one? That's our choice. It's our choice. But we need to have some continuity with what we're used to. So we need to journey to the death-free realm. We can't just instantly shift. I mean, for me, I was thinking, why don't we just instantly shift? No, we can't do it that way. Can't do it that way. Or why don't we just do it here in this world? Because there are too many people, too many hallucinators in this world now who are very skilled in hallucinating death. They're very intensely into that, and they're able to reinforce their hallucinations in so many ways that it will entrain us into hallucinating death and destruction. So it's not a wise thing to stay in this world. It's not wise. It's foolish, as a matter of fact. Very foolish. The notion that somehow we are going to be the ones that prevail here and hallucinate this planet is perfectly healed and peaceful, etc., is, I think it's a whimsical, very whimsical notion, very eccentric notion, because at least temporarily, the ones in charge of this planet are, again, very oriented towards hallucinating death. We don't underestimate the ferocity of that, because literally they feel their salvation depends upon it, literally. And they feel that very deeply and intensely because they want to be prime creator, which gives rise to this whole contingency plan of trying to overcome death. And so they're driven to overcome death. And how do you survive death? Well, everything has to die, and then you have to hallucinate an afterlife or an after death that you've survived it, or a resurrection. You have to hallucinate a resurrection. So they're intensely into that. Don't underestimate it. I feel a lot of people who sort of think they're on a spiritual path are underestimating the times, drastically underestimating what's going on. And for me, my eyes are open, and I just observe and say, my gosh, just look at the video games people play. Who would look at such stuff, such gore? Who, except someone who is absolutely convinced their salvation depends upon it? And they're hallucinating. Hallucinators are dangerous to other hallucinators who can be easily entrained into that. So it does have a profound impact on society. We talk about, well, these video games, what kind of impact, blah, blah, blah. Of course they have a profound impact, because people are hallucinating. They're watching these video games, and they're intensely into thinking, you know, that this is how they want to hallucinate, and that entrains other people. When you hang around those people, bad company, they entrain you into their hallucination, just like on acid trips in the 60s, 70s. If you hang around bad company and they start hallucinating all these reptiles coming and eating them, you'll start hallucinating that way too. Absolutely. So of course, all these people what they're seeing is all these video games, all this incredible gore, these movies with all these reptilian monsters coming after them, and all this shooting and all this stuff. If you hang around them, you will get into that same mindset that you believe this is what's going to happen in the future. This is what's going to take place. All this stuff is entraining the future, entraining how the future is going to be. And again, all existence is hallucination. We don't understand we're hallucinating. So we don't realize that we're hallucinating our future. And by looking at these video games, we are hallucinating that future. By looking at these movies, that's the future we're hallucinating. All this terrible stuff, we are hallucinating it. When I talk about the problems that come in this world, I'm not trying to get people to hallucinate that. I'm trying to get people to sidestep it, to have a happy hallucination. I'm telling them it's necessary because too many people are hallucinating this catastrophic future. And people say, oh, you're negative. So, no, I'm open-eyed and aware that there's all this incarnation of people on this planet are those who are profoundly invested in hallucinating a future like this. And they won't be deterred from it. They won't be deterred from it at this point. So it's Pollyannish to think they can be deterred from it. Very Pollyannish. You cannot have just a group of people chanting and oming and stuff and stop these people. It won't stop them. It won't stop them at all. Just pay no attention to it. We see, we have to account for the variability of hallucination and how it works. You have to see that and be practical about it. There is going to be a dust up in this world. It is sheer arrogance to think someone person or one little group can hallucinate a happy future, and then that will somehow entrain everybody else in this world. Because we all have equal power of hallucination. It's not like there's someone who somehow has greater power necessarily, not really at all. So, actually, by hallucinating a happy future in this world, that only causes the hallucinators who want death and destruction to be even more intense on hallucinating death and destruction. They feel literally that you're trying to annihilate them. You're trying to deprive them of their salvation. And so they hate that. It makes it even worse. That's why Jesus says, resist not evil. Love your enemy. Don't try and force a happy future on them. It only makes it worse. Sidestep it. Sidestep it. Go to a different world. Go to a different place. Sidestep. Go to a beautiful resort. Let them have their death and destruction, because literally by withdrawing, you're not trying to oppose them, and that will literally make it less for them. It'll make it better for them. They'll say, wow, there's no opposition. Where's all the opposition? And it makes it all feel kind of like, this really isn't such a interesting hallucination, because we want battle, we want war, we want conflict. And if there's no conflict, everyone just, they say, well, where's the conflict? And they'll kind of just like, oh, this is boring. It's like, wow, what happened? What went wrong? And then they can be better entrained to happy hallucination. So it's better to not resist the future that they are envisioning here. Don't fight against it. It's better for them. It's more compassionate. It's more helpful, way more helpful. So I don't oppose all these people who are doing this stuff. I'm not in opposition to it whatsoever. I'm saying, hey, everybody who doesn't want that future, sidestep it. Sidestep it. Have a happy hallucination. Journey into a different future. Journey into a happy future. Different place, different planet. Don't think you have to own this planet. Why do you need to own this planet? It's only hallucination. Hallucinate a happy planet. A happy future. Beautiful, happy future. Doesn't have to be on this planet. Absolutely does not. Why? Why? Why does it have to be on this planet? That's very, very parochial, very, very limited, very, very, we don't have to at all. By insisting it has to be on this planet, we are literally becoming cannon fodder for those who are envisioning this death-based future of this planet. We are literally fish in a barrel, ducks on a pond, and that's what's happening, is all these quote-unquote usherettes and ushers are saying, oh, this planet, love the planet, this is our home, that we must stay here, this is our one and only home, and it's so beautiful, and we can have such a wonderful future, all this kind of stuff. That's actually setting us up to be slaughtered here. It's really entirely trying to help those who are hallucinating death, trying to help them succeed at making death real and then overcoming it, surviving it. They're in the employ of that hallucination. Don't be fooled by that. Don't be fooled by those. I've never been fooled by those. Or at least very minimally. maybe for some time minimally, but I sort of was aware, no, this is a trap. This is a trap. Of course, if you're trying to be led into a trap like that, you will try to make the trap seem nice. This world is a trap. Staying in this world is a trap. So all those who are trying to make the idea of staying in this world a beautiful idea for you, an attractive idea for you, they're leading you into a trap, guaranteed. They're leading you into a trap. Now, temporarily, we can use this aspects of this world, areas as beautiful, to get a staging, to get ready to go on a journey to another world. We can do that. That's very different than trying to make this world attractive in order to stay here. Entirely different direction, entirely different usage. So yes, beauty of this world can be used, but there's two different diametrically opposite directions that it's being used for different purposes. Now, if I were to go to a resort, it would be only to use that resort, a beautiful area, as a staging area, as practicing rehearsal ground to journeying to another world, another dimension. I would not use it to say, hey, look how beautiful this resort is. We need to build more resorts in the world. We need to beautify the planet. We need to be dedicated to solving the problems of this planet. I would not use it for that at all. No way. No way. The ones who do that are just leading us into a trap for those who are going to bring out destruction upon this planet. Hallucinating destruction, of course. This is all just nothing but an imagination. This planet, this universe, everything that happens in form and energy is a hallucination. So right use of time, right use of mind, right use of place, that's all important. So I can, if I decided to have this peace accord within me and decide to go along with the happy hallucination, which I want to, I will find suddenly I'll be able to live in this gorgeous, beautiful place and bring people there and rehearse going on a beautiful journey. And all that can be done. And then transport ships will show up and we will go on this beautiful journey and we will go to another realm, a beautiful, beautiful realm, and we'll sidestep all the death and destruction here on this planet. That'll absolutely take place. But staying on this planet and trying to solve the problems is a total misunderstanding of the situation. The only problem we have is the problem of hallucination and the continuity problem of dropping hallucinations. That's the only problem we really have. We don't have problems of a dying planet, of overpopulation. All this stuff is not a real problem at all, not the continuity problem at all. We don't, because we can simply hallucinate another planet. The problem is we're not doing that. That's the issue. That's the issue. So we have to learn how to do that. The problems of hallucinating, making death real, and trying to overcome it will always be there. They will always be full of problems. So trying to solve those problems is the stupidest thing imaginable. You give that scenario a different planet, they'll ruin that planet too. So just continually giving planets and hallucinating how to make death real, of course there'll always be death and destruction and problems in that hallucination, no matter how many planets you give them. So it's futile, useless to go along with that. Absolutely serves no purpose and doesn't solve the problem at all. We have to learn how to have a happy hallucination. That is the answer to the problems of this world. Hallucinate a world where there are no problems. That is the answer to it, literally. Literally, and you have a world full of people here who don't understand that at all, so of course they're going to hallucinate the destruction of this planet. So staying here on this planet and not learning how to hallucinate a happy planet, how to hallucinate another planet is stupid. It's completely stupid. Folly. Whimsical eccentricity. Folly. See, in the past, prior to this time, the planet was not yet going to be destroyed. So people could say, well, we can just hallucinate a beautiful overlay on this planet, and that's fine. But what's coming up on this planet is literally planetary destruction. Destroyed by fire. The planet is going to be melted down, as it were. There is cataclysmic, cosmic destruction coming on this planet at some point fairly soon. But prior to that, there's also mayhem on this planet. World war, terrible diseases, biological warfare, all sorts of terrible, terrible stuff is coming from those who want to make death real. They want to hallucinate that death is real, and then they overcome this death, because that's the only way that they can become prime creator, be greater than God. That's the way, that's the means that there has to be used. That means. And so they will literally bring that about, hallucinate it. They'll hallucinate it and entrain all those here to also believe it's real. Now, it's possible for someone who's awakened to truth to remain in this world and not see any of this, not be touched by it or anything like that, not see. But people will just say, well, they won't be like invisible. People will not relate to them at all. So it's not practical. It's not practical. What is practical is to take this beautiful journey to another realm. That's what's actually practical at this point. So in previous lives, it wasn't necessary in this world because the destruction wasn't so close. But now we're so close to World War III and all of this intense turmoil, heavy turmoil coming upon the world, ultimately resulting in the high energy particle waves, microwaving the world. And we're so close to that that it is necessary right now in our lifetime to take this beautiful journey to a very beautiful realm. Now, I've already done that in consciousness. I did it. I hallucinated it, and saw it. The realm is there. The resort is there. Very beautiful. Way more beautiful in this world. You're going to say, this is way better. Wow, this is way better. Way better place. There's also the death-free realm, which is even better than the resort. So you might say that we're hallucinating a journey to a beautiful resort, and then from that beautiful resort, we're also able to hallucinate a journey to the death-free realm. Okay? I've been both places, actually, already. And I've also seen the transport vehicle that can take us to the beautiful resort, a journey to that beautiful resort. It won't be some instantaneous thing. Now we'll go like on a river cruise or some kind of cruise, like a cruise ship, like a beautiful cruise ship. It'll be like getting on a wonderful cruise ship and taking this really wonderful, beautiful cruise. Oh, and as we cruise, we get into balmier weather. The atmosphere becomes more and more fresh and balmy. We say, oh, the air is so fresh and clean. Ah, oh, the atmosphere is the perfect temperature. Oh my gosh. And the clouds are so beautiful and the water is so crystal and clear and fresh, and it gets better and better and better like that, like a cruise ship going to some beautiful island, some extraordinary beautiful place. And as we go, it gets nicer and nicer and nicer. And that solves the continuity problem to getting there. And again, this is all entirely doable. Because all of existence is just a hallucination, and we can simply hallucinate this. We don't realize we're hallucinating it. We don't realize it. It seems all completely real, and from our standpoint, it is completely realistic. Okay, we can hallucinate. We're already hallucinating in a very realistic fashion. So yeah, it will all seem totally realistic, as if it were real. If it's realistic, it's a realistic hallucination. Just as the hallucination of this world being destroyed will seem very realistic also. Civilization being wiped out will seem very realistic. Just as these video games that people watch seem very realistic. I mean, some of these like video games are like amazing. I just like, wow. I can hardly believe that they are able to make it look so realistic. And they're getting better and better all the time. Soon they'll have video games that we can't tell the difference between whether it's real or not. So realistic. And they're using that, of course, to entrain themselves to destruction and death, those video games, very much so. Or to all types of mind trips and all sorts of conflict. And it's all death-based conflict, it's all threat-based, all threat-based, this stuff. But we don't have to hallucinate a threat-based scenario. We can hallucinate a non-threat-based scenario. Absolutely we can. And I just have to be willing to do that. And God willing, I will do that. I'll be willing to do that. That is what I'm working on so intensely. Instead of saying, I don't need any hallucination at all, forget I don't need it. To say, no, for the standpoint of being helpful, practical, I have to. Have to. Otherwise, I won't be useful at all. That's a fact. And And so I did see this stubbornness got resolved, and I was shocked by it. I thought maybe I'd never be able to resolve this, and it did get resolved. So I'm working on that to do my role. I have a role to play in all this, just as you have a role. Everyone has a role to play in this happy hallucination, just as everyone has a role to play in the hallucination of death and destruction. Some will be the ones that die. Others will be the ones that do the killing, and everyone has in has a role in that scenario, in that hallucination. So basically, I've said what I need to say this morning, and laid on the line here. And some of you hearing this, something within you will say, "Yeah, aha, this is true. This is right. This is right on the money." And others will say, "Ah, this is completely nuts, completely nuts." But based on everything that I've studied and observed and all the experiences I've had, what I'm saying is accurate. What I'm saying is practical, it's helpful, and it's what actually works. It's therapy that actually works. And I see myself as succeeding as in my role, which is a great thing. And therefore, if I can succeed in my role, I know you can succeed in your role too. We all have a role in the happy hallucination, in this journey to a beautiful, happy realm. We all have a role. So let us accept this and say, you know what? A miracle can happen. I actually can get with this. Because for me, it was a miracle what I saw in this dream, that I dropped my opposition and my stubbornness. A miracle. Holy cow. And I was like working with myself now in such a cooperative way. It was the cooperation, the inner cooperation I had was like perfect. It was flawless. It's incredible. Two antagonistic stubborn say, no, I won't cooperate. No, I won't cooperate. Now suddenly they're cooperating beautifully, flawlessly. I was just dumbfounded by that. So an inner miracle is possible. Our stubbornness can suddenly be resolved. It can. So I had this experience already in a dream, and I may have this experience in waking time too, that I suddenly become extraordinarily cooperative. And when one is extraordinarily cooperative, even greater miracles can happen. Even the miracle of journeying to a beautiful another realm, another world can happen. Absolutely it can. But it requires this flawless cooperation, this inner accord, alignment. And that will happen. Okay, very great. Let me get on with some other taping. I'm working on some other meandering tapings that are helpful for us. We need now to get into this beautiful meandering, kind of beautiful meandering, beautiful journey, beautiful meandering. That's kind of what I'm working on for you, and I'll make these tools available. Okay, the best is yet to come for sure. Really, because the dreams I'm having have been extraordinary. Have been extraordinary. Okay, best is yet to come. Hang in there. Thanks for watching. Very great. We'll see you in the next video.